Good evening and welcome. Welcome to our second webinar focusing on holistic health. We welcome you from near and from far. We're so glad for all our viewers in the United Kingdom, across our major cities. Glad also for our visitors and visited this program for the first time, I should say, last week, from mainland Europe, and also from the Caribbean and Africa and North America. I welcome you all to this second airing where we are focusing on holistic health, really giving attention to the vaccine as it relates to COVID-19. I am glad for what has transpired from last week. And I am really very happy to be co-hosting this seminar this evening with Shamara Fletcher. Shamara did an excellent work last week along with our other panelists. And we're so glad, and we want to express our thanks also to our partners, those who have walked with us in this journey, a number of churches and parachurch organizations, including RAFA, including also West Midlands Faith in Action, Sentient Support Services. And we are very happy to announce one of our sponsors, Your Neighbor, which is a part of the Good Faith Partnership. This is really excellent news for us. And we are so very, very glad. And so without saying anything further, let me introduce our co-host for the evening, Shamara Fletcher. Shamara, over to you.
Thank you so much, Bishop Tedroy. Thank you. As has been said, the purpose of this evening is to continue in this very important conversation in the sense of a public dialogue about the COVID-19 vaccine with our national and international audience. As has been said, we really want to thank our partners, especially near neighbours who have also sponsored this event. Now, tonight is going to be an informed space where we're going to have the opportunity to safely debunk myths, as well as tackle some of our legitimate concerns and solutions about the COVID-19 vaccine from a socio-political, theological, and scientific perspective. To give you some context, based on what we spoke about last week, almost 3.2 million of the most vulnerable and those who are in care have already received their first dose. The NHS has also opened its first 7 NHS vaccination centres to vaccinate people over 80, along with those who have health conditions and care staff. Almost 1,200 vaccination sites have already been set up across the UK, and hundreds more will be opening very soon to have access to vaccines for free, regardless of where people live. Now, the government have set a target to offer vaccines to everybody in the top 4 priority groups. This is number 1, residents in care homes with older adults and their carers. Number 2, for those who are over 80 and frontline health care staff, those who are 75 and over, and lastly, those who are 70 and over but are clinically extremely vulnerable. So tonight we are privileged to hear from a host of panelists from the UK who are experts in their field, who will be talking to us and aiding us in our discussion tonight. There's going to be an opportunity for you to ask your questions at the end of their presentations. And there will also be a survey where you can honestly give some feedback about how this webinar has impacted you. So I will now hand back over to our co-host for this evening, our National Presiding Bishop, Bishop Tedroy Powell. Over to you, Bishop.
Thank you, Lady Shamara. And already the tweets are coming in of how elegant you look and how very well you do. thank you. But certainly, Shamara, last week was for me really informative motivational and encouraging. How did you feel about the program last week?
You know, Bishop, I really enjoyed our panel last week. I think it was a balanced, credible space. People were able to ask their questions. And I'm just so glad that we are engaging with different audiences about the vaccine. So, yeah, I think it was a good discussion. I know our chat box was very lively, but that's what we want, is a public dialogue and discussion. So really looking forward to tonight.
Yes, you are right. It was certainly lively. I understood that the sparks were flying, but we want an open, honest responses, questions, and we need proper critique of what is being shared. But I think we'll all agree, and we want to communicate this to our audiences everywhere. Let's be respectful. Unfortunately, there were incidents last week which it was clearly felt that had really breached the boundaries of just good manners and respect. And so Shamara and I and our panelists and all concerned that worked with the team of this production would really want to encourage you, please share your views. Be as critical as you like, but let's be respectful with each other, knowing that everyone has a view and they have the opportunity to air their view. This is the whole object of this. And so we thank you in advance for that. And so then allow us then to introduce to you our guest for this evening. We have with us, honored to have with us, Councillor Sandra Samuels, OBE. Councillor Samuels serves the city of Wolverhampton, the Wolverhampton Council. She's a former cabinet member for public health and well-being, adult social services and corporate governance. She's a council's former cabinet member for public health and well-being, and she has served in the public services for over 40 years. And of course, she brings a wealth of experience in her work as an activist in the local, regional, and national politics. She's also worked with the Unite Union in regards to staff workplace representative. She's a retired NHS manager and a company director. She brings with her also expertise, having worked in the NHS and have retired just over 5 years ago. And she has worked in the sector of art and lung transplant theatres, neurosurgical theatres, and she has also pioneered an NHS initiative, pushing back the clinical boundaries. That sounds really very interesting, and I'm sure she may share a little of that tonight, as she implemented and taught hundreds of nurses to take on the roles of junior doctors, embarking on the Department of Health groundbreaking project, the scope of professional practice during the mid-90s. So everywhere you are, put your hands together, a digital hand clap for Councillor Sandra Samuels. Thank you. We also have with us this evening, Dr. Ahmed Massoud. Dr. Massoud collaborates and works with Dr. Justin Varney, responsible for a public health director in the West Midlands area. But Dr. Massoud is a chief medical officer and chief clinical information officer for the NHS Black Country and West Birmingham, serving and commissioning for a population of over 1.5 million in the West Midlands in the UK. As Chief Medical Officer, he holds executive responsibility for primary care, medicines, management, patient and public engagement, clinical leadership, and development of clinical policy. As CCIO, he supports the digital agenda for transformation and innovation across the patch. And so we welcome you, Dr. Masood. And once again, our audiences everywhere, put your digital hand claps together for Dr. Masood. Thank you. And over to Shamara.
Thank you, Bishop. Thank you. We are also privileged to welcome to our panel this evening Felicia Kwaku, OBE. Now, Felicia was awarded an OBE for her services to nursing on the 9th of October 2020 in the Queen's Birthday Honours List. She's an Associate Director of Nursing for Quality Improvement and Chair of the Chief Nursing Officers Black and Minority Ethnic Strategic Advisory Group at NHS England, and she has been recognised for her services to nursing during the COVID-19 pandemic. Now, Felicia supported Black, Asian and minority ethnic nurses when it became clear that these groups were being disproportionately affected by the virus. She delivered webinars which reached thousands of nurses at a time when they felt vulnerable, scared and worried. Felicia spoke up. She spoke up loudly and decisively about the need for appropriate risk assessment and PPE for nursing staff and other clinical colleagues. In her free time, she supports individual nurses and managers, as well as members of the community who are distressed and fearful about the potential impact of COVID-19 on them and their families. Felicia, we welcome you to our panel this evening. And please, everyone who's under the sound of our voice this evening, please give a great clap for Felicia. Thank you for being with us this evening. We appreciate you and look forward to your contribution. We also have Minister Jackie Ferguson with us on our panel this evening. Now, Minister Jackie has a keen interest in health for over 20 years. This arose out of family illness and has developed since that time. She's worked collaboratively with organisations such as charities and local authorities, including the National Fostering Agency, providing support, advice workshops, seminars and lectures on health and well-being. Since 2016, she has been involved with the Willesden New Testament Church of God's annual Health Day programme in London as one of their speakers. Jackie has also worked with a number of other individuals providing consultation services to those in need of help with weight management, healthy eating, the impact of health, and with lifestyle changes due to ill health. Jackie, we look forward to your contributions this evening, and let us all give a virtual for you. It's so great to have you. I'll now hand over to Bishop Tedrow.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Mara. We are also very glad to have with us Bishop Llewellyn Graham. Bishop is no stranger, certainly to myself, nor many of us that works within the circuit of a Church of God of Prophecy, but wider than that, much wider. He works ecumenically and wider still within the sociological sphere as being the Chief Executive Officer for Nehemiah Church Housing Association. Bishop Llewellyn has more letters to his name than his actual name, in fact. B.A. Honours, M.A., M.B.A., M.I.O.D. Do you want me to carry? No, okay, I'll pause there. Bishop, he is certainly a man that's very well qualified, but he's humble, approachable, loves the God's creation, God's people everywhere, and serves with focus and intensity. He is a fourth generation member of the Church of God of Prophecy. And since he came to faith at the age of 14, and he has grown in experience, grown in his service of excellence to God. As mentioned, he is the Chief Executive Officer of Nehemiah Housing Association since its registration in 1989. He has successfully led this charity through a merger with United Churches Housing Association to form Nehemiah UCHA, that's the largest Black majority church established social action organization of its kind in the UK. a leading multi-million pound enterprise providing housing and care for over 4,000 people. Yes, 4,000 people in the West Midlands. He's a founder member and current vice chair of RAFA International Development Agency, who's partnering us in this webinar, providing charitable intervention for the relief of poverty in Africa, the Caribbean, and other developing countries. He became its first executive director as a secondee of Nehemiah in 2005. And so I ask you, please put your digital hands together everywhere and appreciate Bishop Llewellyn Graham. Bishop, we thank you. And so we are very, very thrilled this evening to be presenting to you the second part of our webinar on holistic health focus. It's important for us to do so because we want to critically examine the information that's been presented and given to us. We want to be able to provide solid information for you, reliable, trustworthy information for you to decide as to whether or not you will go forward and take the vaccine. And so the panel is very well balanced. As mentioned, we have experts in a number of fields, but we really also have in particular Minister Jackie, who has some critical questions, really, probing and deep diving into what's being presented. And her role tonight is not so much agent provocateur, but rather one where she will ensure that what is being presented and what we have heard has really been tested and tested rigorously and robustly. So we look forward to this evening. And so we once again welcome you. But before we go into presentations, we're going to have a time of worship. Worship reflectiveness is important for all of our well-being. It's holistic health. And what greater way or what more rewarding way to start than to have a musical worship song? Thank you.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, you're my God. Hallelujah, 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 you're my God. Hallelujah, 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 you're my God. Hallelujah, 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 you're my God. You're my healer, my defender. You're my healer, you're my God. You're my healer, my defender. You're my healer, you're my God. Hallelujah, 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 you're my God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, my God. Hallelujah, you're my God. Yes, you are, yes, you are. Hallelujah, you're my God. Hallelujah, you're my God. Hallelujah.
Minister Carol, what a beautiful rendition of that song. Thank you. There's now an opportunity to get involved with our poll, our live poll that we will be launching this evening.
So here.
We are going to be putting the live poll up, and then you will be able to take these details down, whether you're tuning in from Zoom or YouTube, so that you can engage in our poll. And then towards the end of the evening, after our plenary, we will then look at that poll again. So this is a great opportunity for you to be involved in the launch of our live poll for our webinar, to hear your views, to see what you are saying. And that information is going to come on our screens in a moment, where you can engage and interact with our poll. And then towards the end of the evening, we will put that information up again and you can participate in our live poll. We're really looking forward to hearing from you. So now we are going to hear from our first panelist, which is our very own Bishop Llewellyn Graham, who will be speaking to us from a socio-political perspective. Over to you, Bishop Llewellyn.
Thank you so much to our host, Bishop Tedroy Powell and Sister Shamara Fletcher, fellow panelist, and this evening's virtual audience. Good evening and greetings to you all. This evening, I will be sharing from my own perspective as a minister that works in the community and also as the Chief Executive Officer of Nehemiah Housing Association based in the West Midlands. For those of you who do not know, Nehemiah Housing provides social housing primarily, and support services for those people of African and Caribbean descent, but also for the wider Black, Asian, and minority ethnic communities across the region. A significant proportion of our client base are elderly people living in our sheltered housing schemes. We have approximately 7 of those across the region. And that makes us the largest specialist social housing provider in the region for Black, Asian, and minority ethnic older people. In our schemes, we provide specialist support for African Caribbean older people, for Asian older people, and also for Irish and European communities. Their health, their safety, and their well-being has been and will continue to be our number one priority during these corona days. The rate of COVID infection and deaths, as has been previously mentioned in our webinar last week and other webinars, has disproportionately affected people from Black, Asian, and minority ethnic communities. But what is more troubling in recent polls is that some 72% of African Caribbean people and 42% of Asian people have stated that they are less likely to take the vaccine. And there are concerns that has been raised that they are being targeted by campaigners spreading anti-vaccine propaganda. Now, in the last year, we have suffered unimaginable tragedy, and many of us have lost our loved ones. In our church, we have lost many of our senior leaders. In our communities, many friends and our neighbors. And one of the most upsetting things during these corona days is that our traditional way of celebrating the lives of our loved ones, we have not been able to do so. It's almost a cultural shock to people in the community to be having funeral services with 10 people, moving to a maximum of 30 most recently for funeral services. And we are now streaming to ensure a wider audience. Now, this is alien to us as people of African and Caribbean heritage. We are people that like to gather and celebrate and shake hands. Our churches have been closed, and understandably so, because we want to protect our people. But we are worshipers, and our worshiping communities have not been able to gather in the ways that we have traditionally been able to and celebrate our faith. So both spiritually and socially, we have been severely affected by this virus. I understand why people are cautious, but COVID-19 is a vicious illness which can kill young people as well as older people. It leaves others with long COVID symptoms lasting weeks and months. Many in our communities, including my own staff, are working in the front line, caring for people as essential workers, constantly at risk of catching and potentially up to 4 times more likely to die from the virus. The vaccine, in my view, finally provides a way out of this dire situation and a way of protecting those who need it most. I understand the questions and the concerns, and what this webinar is designed to do this evening is to help to answer some of those questions and concerns. Here are some of the concerns and the questions that I have come across. Does the vaccine contain a microchip so that Bill Gates can track us? Or does coronavirus is being spread by 5G mast to control us? Are the vaccines safe for people like us, meaning black people and people of minority ethnic origin? It's all been done so quickly. Can we trust this? Will the vaccines work differently on ethnic minority communities? Are the vaccines halal or kosher for those with religious perspectives? And you've heard last week, does it contain animal or fetal products? Could a vaccine give you COVID? Are there better ways of protecting yourselves? Could the vaccines affect your DNA or fertility? Now, these are good questions, and they are legitimate questions, and they are questions that should be answered. And I'm sure that there are members on this panel this evening, as well as those who spoke last week, were able to give and are still able to give some answers to some of those questions. But from my perspective as a minister working in the community, and also have responsibility, leading responsibility for the lives of vulnerable people, I have also come to my own conclusion based on what I've heard so far. And despite my own initial reservations, I want to go on record as welcoming the vaccine. And I want to urge you, all of you, we all must do what we can and come together to fight this deadly virus. Of course, it is an individual decision, and you must make your decision based on the evidence presented to you. But in the final analysis, we have to take corporate responsibility, especially for those who cannot fend for themselves and who we are charged to protect. Doctors and scientists have found a way out of this pandemic, a way that, in my view, is safe and will help to save lives. We have been working with a number of health associations across the country to help to answer some of these questions that has been raised. And we want to do that because we feel it is important that we give factual information to people to enable them to make an informed decision on this matter of vaccination. So many have had questions and are still asking questions. And of course, it is important for you to have those questions and ask them. However, on balance, I believe that there is no credible evidence to suggest that the vaccine poses a greater threat to us than the virus itself. So I believe getting the jab is by far the best way to protect yourself, your family, and your community from the coronavirus, even if you've had this virus before. And I want to conclude with a scripture, and it's 2 Timothy 1, verse 7, and I'm going to read this from the Amplified Bible. It says, "For God did not give us a spirit of timidity or cowardice or fear, but he has given us a spirit of power and of love and of sound judgment and personal discipline, which is the ability that results in calm, well-balanced mind and self-control." So I leave that with you. And thank you for listening. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you, Bishop Llewellyn. That is indeed quite informative, certainly connected from a personal basis of your ministry and your service in the community. Quite alarming statistics there. Which we were aware of in part, certainly to know that 72% of Black African people and over 40% of Asians in our communities, typically across the country, have said no to the vaccine. This is alarming, and surely it's the necessity of programs like this and others. And let me at this point, and I'm sure Shamara will want to do the same, commend churches and other organizations who are raising their voices in the public square to actually inform, provide reliable information. It is sad when there is direct misinformation sowed to provide confusion. Shamara, how do you respond to these statistics?
You know, it from a statistical point of view, it can come across as alarming. But if we look at our community, how they've engaged with healthcare systems, criminal justice systems and the different treatments in society, I'm not overly surprised that there would now be a skepticism for this push of a vaccine. So yeah, I think there's so many different things that come into play that aid the skepticism, but I'm just so glad that we are having this conversation and that church in their influence and public platform to host conversations such as this for objectivity, credibility, and for people to ask their honest questions.
Yes, I agree with you. Thank you, Shamar. And just before we hear from Felicia, just love to reveal to you just a quick straw poll, just to test the mood, as it were. And we asked 130 people on Zoom, would they take the poll? Just a straight question, yes or no? And we've had 52% have said yes, and 48% have said no. That's just a quick straw poll. So that's where it stands at present. So what we will be doing, Shamar and I, we'll be collating other polls throughout and taking a final poll towards the end, just so we can measure the transition, the movement in people's views, etc. So because I am convinced that the information that will be presented will help the process of making a decision. So thank you. And so we now go over to our second panelist, Felicia.
Hello, my name is Felicia Kwaku, and good evening, everyone, or maybe good afternoon or good morning, wherever you are. And I am going to just relay my story, really, and experiences of nurses working on the front line. So can we start with the first slide, please? The next slide, please. So this is quite a stark slide. On this slide, I think this slide was produced probably in April, May, this picture, and it was the title on one of the national newspapers. And at that time, it showed the number of staff that had died from COVID-19. And you will note that when you look at that picture, that the large majority of people on that slide are from Black, Asian, minority ethnic backgrounds. Now on the second line, there's a Black gentleman with glasses, and that's Dr. Alpha Sadu. And he was my colleague. I worked with him at Ealing Hospital many years ago. And when I heard that he had died, I was absolutely shocked. Such a lovely man, a fantastic doctor that had actually retired and had come back to the NHS to help out for the pandemic. So if we go to the next slide, it became very alarming early on that there was a disproportionate impact of COVID-19 on Black, Asian, and ethnic communities. We started to see some seminal reports. We had some significant data from the Office of National Statistics and significant data from the Institute of Fiscal Studies that showed us that if you were from a Black Afro-Caribbean background, you were four times likely to die from COVID. If you were from Asian, and even within Asian, and even with the Black character categories, there were still some differences. You were nearly three times likely to die from COVID. So these were very, very alarming statistics. And the system, I would have liked the system to be much more responsive to those statistics, because those statistics were causing quite a lot of alarm and distress amongst not just the Black, Asian, minority and ethnic communities, but actually the staff that were working on the ground floor. And you will see that in response to that, there were two reports on the left-hand side led by Public H England that started to unpick and interrogate the data around the reasons why people from ethnic communities were dying and contracting the COVID-19 virus in quite high rates. Can we go to the next slide, please? So it's important to understand that context, because within the National Health Service, people from ethnic communities contribute quite a large portion of the healthcare workforce. You will note that approximately 40% of doctors within the NHS come from Black and Asian backgrounds. And within nursing and midwifery, almost 20% of nurses and midwives come from ethnic backgrounds. So you can see that we form a large part of the healthcare landscape. And this is just within the NHS. Don't forget that we have staff from ethnic backgrounds also working outside of the NHS in the healthcare landscape. And on the right-hand side, you will see some of the statistics that just underpin what I've just said around the likelihood of death and the likelihood of contracted COVID-19 on the right-hand side. Next slide, please. So I'm part of a group called the Chief Nursing Officers BME Strategic Advisory Group. And as part of my role, I am often asked to take part on steering groups and to take part on panels. And this is a particular work stream called Deaths in Service. And the purpose of the work stream was to look at the data that was emerging around the workforce, the ethnic workforce. And at that time, this data is taken from June, we had approximately 216 NHS staff deaths. And when you look at them, when you break those down those numbers, the majority of those staff were in inpatient settings. And we know that in the inpatient settings, in the acute settings, that's where the viral load is quite high. Saying that, we also know that the viral load would have been very high in care homes. And we know a lot of patients died. And we also know that quite a number of staff also contracted COVID-19 from those workplaces as well. When they further then broke down the staffing numbers and they looked at the backgrounds of the staff that actually died, you can see quite significantly that the largest group of staff were from the Black and minority ethnic group. And at that time, it comprised of 62% of the total figure. So once again, that was contributing to very, very alarming alarms and distress among the ethnic workforce. And you will see on the box on the right hand side, you will see the age profile. And we know amongst the profile of death that males are much more at risk. We also know that age is the highest risk for contracting the disease and for death as well. And you will see that the highest age profile was between 40 and 70 years old. The next slide, please. So as we continue, it's really significant and of note that where are our ethnic staff? Where are they positioned? And this slide, the top picture or organogram will show you, this is data from the Workforce Race Equality Standard. So this is data that analyzes the bands, the grades of where staff sit and what the backgrounds are of where those staff sit. And the blue bars are the white staff, and they will vary from grades, normally grades from grades 1 to grades 9 and VSM, which is the most senior management roles. And you will find the red bars are where the ethnic staff are placed, and you can see a pattern. And the pattern is that the lower the grade, which will be a band 1, 2, 3, 4 for nurses, we start at a grade 3 and 4. You will see that we cluster, ethnic staff are clustered in bands 4, 5, and 6. When you look at where are most patients in their acute care systems, they are in the wards or in care homes, and they are staff that are on the ground floor. So they will be much more exposed to viral loads. And this is not unusual. You will find that ethnic staff struggle to go up the ladder. Where you find is that they will be clustered in those very junior roles. And that is where, if you like, the hard graft is, and that is where you will have most contact with the patients. So in view of this emerging evidence, it was really stark that staff were very anxious, they were very distressed. And there was a couple of things that came to me at that time. I remember talking to a matron, and she said to me, "Felicia, I didn't come to work to die." And the other thing that staff were telling us was that they were dying and that their treatment was different to their colleagues who weren't Black or Asian or came from an ethnic background. So So it was really important to understand what people were saying anecdotally on the floor, but actually what was actually happening. So as part of my team's work, we galvanized ourselves very quickly and we decided to hold some engagement events across the whole of the NHS footprint. So that would be approximately eight regions from north to the south, to East Midlands, to the northeast of Yorkshire, all of the NHS footprint regions. And we held some engagement events. They started with a panel of eminent speakers, nursing midwifery speakers predominantly, but we also had statisticians and people that were experts in their field. And they kind of set the foundation for what we was going to talk about. And then we encouraged staff to talk about their experiences. We held nine of these telephone conferences, and one of them included a talk with students and the health education providers as well, because we also were hearing intelligence about the anxiety among student nurses. And suffice to say that since that time, and in these first set of engagement sessions, we talked to approximately 1,600 staff. Currently, since then, we've held a further engagement events, and we've probably talked to several thousand by now. And it's really important to engage with people. It's not good to make assumptions about what their experiences are. You actually have to engage with them and hear what they are telling you. So in the next slide, you will see what they told us. And they were very clear what they told us. They told us that if you were an agency nurse working within the system, that your rights, your access to equipment, your access to risk assessments was very, very poor. Some of the staff actually told us that managers were hiding the PPE from them. This is the personal protective equipment. That would include masks, aprons, gloves, etc. This was very, very hard to hear. We were told that communication was very variable, in that information from the management wasn't consistent, so they were in the dark sometimes. We were told that in terms of discriminatory practices, that some staff were disproportionately being redeployed to COVID-19 areas. Now, we understand we're in the business of caring. We understand we're here to care for patients, whether they have COVID-19 or not. But the balance of allocating staff has to be equal and has to be fair. And they told us that wasn't happening. They also told us that if you're on maternity leave, there was quite robust protocols from the Royal College of Obstetricians, that if you were 28 weeks pregnant, that you had to go off and be shielding. But many staff told us that those protocols weren't being applied to them as ethnic staff. Safeguarding came up as an issue in terms of whistleblowing and being able to expose their vulnerability. And during some of the calls, we actually had to stop the calls at some point and actually take some staff offline and manage their distress, because they were very, very distressed. And it was interesting to note some of their managers were on the line as well. So we had to be really confident and keep them safe. They also told us about the mental health and the stress and the anxiety within the workplace setting, because at that time, we're talking about the first wave last year, the information and the evidence around the vaccine, virus was still emerging. We were still unsure about how to manage and treat this virus. So people were very, very scared. And I saw and worked with some very, very terrified staff. They were very, very scared. And this was not just nurses. This were domestics, porters, doctors. People were very, very scared. Many of the issues came up around personal protective equipment. We know that the guidance changed many times in the first wave of pandemic. That scared people. It brought a lot of mistrust within the system. It was clear that nationally there was not enough PPE, and people knew that. People knew this, so they did not feel safe. And a particular issue was around the masks, the FFP3 masks. We discovered quite early on that you have to have them fitted tightly to your face, and that's a procedure that you have to undergo. And a number of staff from specific ethnic backgrounds, the mask didn't fit, because actually the standard FFP3 mask is made for a white Caucasian male. So if you're a female, if you have different sets of features, the mask didn't fit. And once again, that was exposing some vulnerabilities. The risk assessments were a huge issue because when they were first released, they didn't cater or were adapted for people from ethnic minorities. And testing was a big issue because nurses were reporting that they didn't have access to testing. So the next slide, please. So in the next slide, you will see that once we completed all these engagement sessions, we made a list of recommendations, and you can see all the recommendations here. And the principle of the recommendations was to make sure that we kept nurses and midwives safe, that they had the right level of equipment, that they were not being disproportionately redeployed to areas, that we could protect them if they spoke up. We also recommended that there would be culturally appropriate mental health services. There is no point having a mental health profession with somebody that doesn't always look like you. For people of ethnic communities, there's a bit of stigma still around mental health provision, so they have to be culturally sensitive. We also recommended that the issue about faith was really important. We prayed hard during this time, like we've never prayed before, and that was really important. And we also made recommendations that every single death should be reviewed. Next slide, please. So how was it then? What was our staff experience? So there are ups and downs. There were lots of highs. So the pandemic really forced and encouraged people to work really well in terms of teams. We had to put on really rapid education and training. We had to move staff from, for example, outpatient areas to the wards and to the intensive care unit. We worked long hours. It was really tough, and it remains tough. And the levels of sickness were very, very high at the time. And a lot of the levels of sickness were due to anxiety. It was very important, I think, for the system to have a command and control. So all the major decisions came from the executive leads. However, some of the decisions sometimes were very quick, and some of them weren't, without the necessary collaboration with staff, because they needed to be made quickly. And so staff often felt that they were left out. One of the key things as well is that because the guidance kept changing, we quickly found that our occupational health services were very overwhelmed. And even the 111 system was very overwhelmed. And we're still working our way through now a very traumatized healthcare workforce. So in the next slide, these are pictures of some of my team, some of the great nurses that we work with. And I just wanted to tell you a story about Richard Freepong, who is the gentleman with the purple top. He's our matron, one of our matrons. He's been in nursing for well over 25 years, and he got COVID. He's actually listening to the webinar this evening. A fantastic gentleman, a fantastic nurse. And this was him pre-COVID, and he actually ended up in the intensive care unit. So there is a video here, if you wouldn't mind playing it. And this is just an excerpt of him when he's back on the ward.
I know he's a family man, and he works hard for his family. So I'm really, really glad that he is pulling through. And I'm praying now, all my prayer is for his rehabilitation, for that rehabilitation to be as quick and fast as possible. And I believe it's going to happen.
You know, my work, I don't think I've never been sick. You know, I always look forward to coming to work. And it feels a bit strange that, you know, you're there. So obviously the quicker I recover, I would love to come back to my normal self and do my work.
He's very excited to come home. And yeah, he calls me a million times a day. I think he doesn't know. Well, we hope he doesn't know about the surprise we have for him.
Thank you. So just like to finish in my last slide, the next slide, please. With some key things to just leave you with. And so it's my comparison really from the first wave to this wave. And in this wave, what we're finding very hard if you're a person on the ground, whether you're in a care home, in mental health services, whether you're acute hospital setting, is the speed and the spread is much faster in this second wave than it was in the first wave. In this second wave, the speed of death is high. I remember the peak in the first wave was in April. I think we've had our peak now in just before Christmas and mid-January. And I remember there was one week where we'd had maybe 20 plus deaths. I have been through a week not long ago where we've had 64 patients die in one week. So it's traumatizing, okay? I know as healthcare professionals we are used to that, but it's traumatizing for families and patients, and it's traumatizing for us as well. We have people with long COVID. We have many staff that caught COVID that with long COVID symptoms. We now have the vaccine. That is a beacon of hope. We understand that there are many reasons why people don't want to take it, and that's a personal choice, but we have it here. We have staff now that are really, really exhausted, and they're very tired. They need a holiday, they need a break. And the focus has to be on health and well-being now. And there is also a degree of moral injury. And when I talk about moral injury, I mean staff feeling hopeless, staff feeling that they've not been able to give their best, staff being asked to do things that they never would do, staff being asked to nurse instead of having one nurse to one patient in the intensive care unit, they're nursing 4 to 5 patients. It's never heard of outside of a pandemic. Staff sickness continues and staff are still dying. And one of the key things before I go around this whole issue was about staff deaths. So a number of nurses that have died during wave 1 and 2 is higher than all the nurses that died in World War I. How can that be? And how can it be right that Black, Asian and ethnic minority nurses have died in such high numbers? Is absolutely unacceptable. And we know that there are many reasons. We know occupational exposure is one of the key reasons, and we know all about the other high health inequalities. So we will continue to champion the work of the Chief Nursing Officers BME Strategic Advisory Group. We will continue to champion safety for nurses and midwives, and nurses have still died. A nurse died on Friday, a nurse died at the end of January. We're still dying, and that cannot continue. So that's the story. That's what it's like to be on the front line. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Felicia, for sharing the real life experience of what it feels like to be on the front line and the trauma that is being involved in our communities, and also for shedding light on the huge contribution that our Black and Asian minority nurses are making in the national landscape of health. You know, thank you also for sharing the alarming statistic that the largest groups that have actually died in the healthcare system have come from BAME communities, in fact, 62%, as you shared with us. And finally, we just really thank you for showing us the nuances involved in the reasons for why this is happening based on your national listening campaigns, from staff being in lower grades and having more exposure to the disease, and also what you mentioned about our BAME staff being clustered into junior roles due to structural ceilings inhibiting progression into senior roles. So thank you for sharing what's happening, even down to the making of masks not necessarily reflecting the diversity of the UK. So thank you so much for this very important information and adding this to our discussion this evening. We are now going to hear from Councillor Samuels, who will be speaking to us about the COVID-19 vaccine from a socio-political perspective. Over to you, Councillor Samuels.
Thank you very much. So ladies, gentlemen, young people here in the UK and audiences abroad, I bring greetings. So I wish to take this opportunity before I go any further just to say a huge thank you to Bishop Tedroy Powell, Church of God of Prophecy UK, and Sister Maxine Douglas from West Midlands Faith in Action, both who had asked me to participate in this evening's discussion on such a, for me, a hugely important, controversial, and very topical subject, the coronavirus vaccine. So asking the question this evening, and I will try and address some of these issues, asking the question to take it or not to take it. So I was responsible for public health in Wolverhampton. Wolverhampton has a population of some 260 individuals, with 35.5% of that population being from the BAME community. So I transferred public health from the NHS back in 2012, back into local government. And I was under the impression that by doing this, it was going to help us to address the public's health, but also some of those comorbidities that is, for me, fairly stark among the BAME population, 35.5% of them within Wolverhampton. I was also involved in last year's inquiry, and the inquiry was around, for me, the comorbidities following the COVID pandemic. So back in June, six of us got together alongside Baroness Doreen Lawrence and Liam Byrne, who is also our shadow mayor in Wolverhampton and the West Midlands. So for us, it was about the alarms that was raised back in March when we had 60% of COVID patients in one of Birmingham's largest hospitals were actually from the BAME community. And I think this is actually what drove the inquiry. We didn't feel that the government was addressing the issue and felt that something needed to be done. So that 3.5 month inquiry is being carried out, submitted alongside Doreen Lawrence's national inquiry around the fatalities among the BAME community. But until this day, we are still waiting to hear from central government, Boris Johnson, about the 35 recommendations following the 3.5 month inquiry that was submitted to him. So as a way of introduction, I want to just state that, just an example, because obviously this is from a political, a socio-political perspective. Few diseases frightened parents more in the earlier part of the 20th century than polio did in the 1950s. And so we're obviously here to talk about the vaccine and why we feel that the vaccine is important. But there are pertinent questions that have been asked, and we want to ensure that our local population, our communities are aware of some of the issues and concerns around taking or not taking the vaccine. So according to the World Health Organization, and I'm going to give you some stark figures here, over 2 billion doses of polio vaccines are administered to more than 400 million children in over 50 countries each and every year, year on year. And I'm going to repeat that again because it's very important. So over 2 billion doses of polio vaccines are administered to more than 400 million children in over 50 countries each and every year, year on year. And you're asking me why I'm using this example. Poliomyelitis, better known as polio, a fatal infectious disease, is caused by the wild polio virus. There are no cure, but due to safe and effective vaccine, transmission and fatalities can be prevented. So according to the World Health Organization and UNICEF, of the 125 polio epidemic countries, today only two countries in the world have never managed to stop the transmission of the polio virus. And those two countries are Pakistan and Afghanistan. For me, as long as one child has the polio virus, then all children are at risk of the disease. I will state what the COVID-19 vaccine, what it is, where it has come from, how was it developed, I will touch on, and why we feel we may or may not need it. I'm a politician, but a nurse first and foremost, with a background of 40 years in the National Health Service. I've probably administered hundreds, if not thousands, of vaccination in hospital and the care setting. I will also at this stage state that my father has been vaccinated with the COVID vaccine the first week of January. My father is 92. He's received the Pfizer vaccine with no adverse reactions. I want him to live for many more years, but I also want him to be able to go along on his cruises like he always has done, which COVID-19 has put a stop to people's way of life. I've lost many nursing colleagues, friends during this dreadful pandemic, and their loved ones. I've listened to hours of testimonies during a 3.5 month West Midlands inquiry into the disproportionate numbers of BAME members dying, Black, Asian, and minority members. So audience, I get it. I get the mistrust among the NHS. I get the structural racism experienced by our patients in some of our hospitals, and that also includes myself. I get the lack of appropriate communication that should have been out there and available to members of our community. So I'm talking to you about the polio epidemic. So what lessons can be learned from this polio epidemic in the 1950s? A lot of you sitting in our audience will be saying, it's before my time. You'll say it's not relevant. This is the 21st century. Well, as someone from the healthcare profession, I beg to differ. The polio vaccine was tested in a placebo-controlled trials back in 1954. 1.6 million children in Canada, Finland, and the United States. And the polio vaccine was actually first used back in 1955. So for me, 65 years ago. Throughout the first half of the 20th century, the polio virus would arrive like a perfect storm, arriving each summer without warning. No one knew how this transmission, no one knew what caused it. The fear of the uncertainty surrounding the coronavirus vaccine may feel new. And that's the questions that I've been asking out there. It is new. Why have we developed this so quickly? Coronavirus vaccine may feel new to many of us, but to those in the 1950s, who for me, some of them are still around at this moment in time, it is strangely familiar. And while I was doing my research, I also realized that someone who is on our regularly on our television, Mary Berry, suffered with the polio virus as a 13-year-old, and she's ended up with a curved spine and problems with her arm. So polio actually leads to paralysis. And we must remember that when polio came about, a lot of people didn't know what the cause was. And it was thanks to a vaccine that was developed back in the 50s that actually treated this. So much like coronavirus vaccine, there were misinformation, conspiracy theories in the 1950s. So for the next four decades, you know, same that is happening here. We would have swimming pools being closed during the virus season. We would have people, individuals actually keeping children from playing outside for fear of catching the virus. So what of this coronavirus vaccine? So a lot of names have been bandied about at the moment. So Pfizer, BioNTech, the Oxford AstraZeneca, the Moderna vaccine, all which has been licensed at the moment, and two which presently are used in Wolverhampton, which is the Pfizer and the Oxford AstraZeneca. So what is this COVID-19? And I can't believe that after 12 months, people still ask about this, about the vaccine, but also ask what it is. So coronavirus is SARS-CoV-2, and it's a severe acute respiratory syndrome. A bat coronavirus made its debut in the human population back in November 2019. By January 2020, the virus was isolated and its genetic sequence was defined. So with that information, it was possible to develop a vaccine to prevent coronavirus killing our population. By the end of 2020, two vaccines, and both of them I mentioned earlier on, were available, both based on a strategy employed. And I'm sure that our medic on the panel this evening may want to talk a little bit about that. But just to say that obviously, I mentioned earlier on, it serves as a blueprint to direct cells to make the coronavirus spike protein. The protein is responsible for attaching protein to the cells, and this is what actually blocks the virus. So there is also questions asked about the speed of which this vaccine has been developed. And it's been some 13 months, hasn't it? This vaccine was owed largely to, I believe, $24 billion allotted by the federal government to mass produce the vaccine at the same time, at the very same time as large clinical trials involved tens of thousands of participants were performed to prove that the vaccine was safe and effective. The polio vaccine actually took 6 years, but millions died. So one of the other questions I've been asked is, what role has BAME scientists played in the development of this vaccine? So I did a bit of research and came across black scientists who played roles in COVID vaccine. December 2020, Kismakia Corbett, a PhD, African-American female, is among the National Institute, is the National Institute of Health Scientists working directly to develop and produce the Moderna COVID-19 vaccine. So we have had black scientists involved in the vaccine development. What I want to say at this stage is that Dr. Corbett works important, actually states that it is important for Black students because they are less likely to enter the field of science, technology, and engineering, the so-called STEM field. But since then, what seems to be happening is that the studies, the sciences, we've now realized in 2020 that those figures of Black scientists involved have now started to fall, which is not a good thing. So what of the COVID vaccine? Inequalities in health, and this is from the health perspective, as well as local government, has seen things like the Marmot Review back in 2010 around health inequalities in England. The Black Report, published in 1980, and the Marmot Review in 2010. What we are saying is that health inequality still exists, but COVID-19 has shown and shone a spotlight actually on health inequalities even more. And until this day, and I'm here sitting here this evening saying that one of our recommendations were to ask government to ensure that ethnicity was on death certificates. Because as I speak, what we still don't have is the recording of ethnicity on death certificates. So if you die in hospital, it will be recorded, but you'll find now that if you die at home or in the community, there is no way of actually recording your death as a member of the BAME community. I want to say at this stage, and I realize I may have gone over my time a little, that it is important. It is important for us to get the right information, but it is also important, and I get it, I really do. I hear your concerns. But we do want to keep our ethnic minorities within our communities, Black, Asian, you know, Black men are four times more likely if they contract COVID. And Asian men are three times more likely to die from the disease. What we are saying is that it is important to have the vaccine to save our lives. We've seen far too many deaths. And to close, I'd like to say, please do not die in ignorance. Please do not die in ignorance. The vaccine is available to all of us. And as soon as they call me, I'd be there like a shot. Thank you very much, host. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Councillor Sandra. Greatly appreciated. You were rendered some precious nuggets from your journey, a professional journey, your personal experience, informing us of an important parallel in regards to the polio. And yes, one would say the polio isn't respiratory, but however, it's a very important parallel to draw. Because when you look at the time that it took for the vaccines to be developed, where millions died, 6 years for the vaccine to be developed. But the reality is that, of course, knowledge has advanced. And given that we are now beginning of the 21st century, it would take a much shorter time to develop the vaccine coming from the science base, which in many ways answers some of the questions that have been addressed to us. But we commend you for the work that's been done, working in collaboration with Dame Doreen Lawrence in that inquiry, and putting recommendations, 35 recommendations, if my memory is right, what you've just shared to the government. And I really do trust, and if there are any listeners in our audience from government local or national, central government. I do trust that the inquiry, the great work that's been done, the responses would be given to that. I think it's of critical importance given what it is that we are walking through at present. And you mentioned also, Councillor Sandra, the work that's been done in regards to polio. When I think of the vaccines that's been distributed over the period of time, over to 50 countries, and I believe 2 billion doses of vaccine to 400 million people in 50 countries, that is enormous. That is enormous, the amount of work that is being done. And if my research serves me right, I believe that the Bill Gates Foundation has indeed contributed something in the region of $3.7 billion to eradicating the polio across Africa, which in many ways pops up the question, well, why would he suddenly want to be putting microchips in the current vaccines? But that's just me. I'm just raising that for discussion. But thank you so much. Really very, very helpful. But there's one point too, which I of course would like to flag up, the ethnicity on death certificates. That is of great significance, and certainly going forward from here, we would want to link, connect with you through West Midlands Faith in Actions and other agencies to raise that matter, because it is of equally great importance. So thank you again, and we appreciate that. In our discussion panel, we can come back to some of the matters that has been raised. And over to my colleague Shamara, who will introduce our next guest.
Thank you, Bishop Ted Roy. So now we will hear from Dr. Masood. He will be speaking to us from a biomedical perspective. Over to you, Dr. Masood.
Thank you, Shamara. Firstly, thank you for inviting me. I think it's very humbling to be welcomed to an event like this, where we have not only our communities that are local tuning in, but also around the world. And thank you as well for inviting me to be part of such an esteemed panel. I think a lot of what I'd wanted to say has actually been covered so eloquently by previous panelists. Try not to repeat and touch upon some of the other areas. I'll start with vaccine does. So one of the confusions is around vaccine works. And I think Councillor Sandra touched upon it. But essentially, with a vaccine, the vaccine primes the body. And so when we provide the vaccine and we give it to someone, what it does is it helps create memory cells. And those memory cells are then primed, and it takes a few weeks for them to replicate and get to a level that provides protection. But what it means is that if you do get an infection, you're ready to fight that infection, and you can produce antibodies, which are produced by the body whenever you have any type of infection, to help fight that infection. And so that's important, because what it means is that in terms of the infection, it will reduce the severity. And much of what we've discussed has been about the deaths. And certainly within our BAME populations, that's been of significant concern. So by priming the body and by having the vaccination, it may not prevent you from getting the getting the illness, but it will definitely reduce the severity and hopefully keep you out of hospital. I think another thing that I was going to touch upon is the issue of a level of hesitancy. And certainly we heard from Bishop Llewellyn that a poll in January showed that 2% of those from a black background would actually hesitate and refuse vaccination. I'd like to add a bit of detail to that in terms of our experience over the last few months. Some of that hesitation actually is not necessarily a refusal, but it's a, I want to wait. And so a number of our GPs that have been delivering vaccines, especially in areas such as Sandwell and West Birmingham, where there is a significant Black, Asian and minority ethnic population, what they found is that a number of individuals have simply said, I'm not sure, I want to wait for the moment. And what's happened is our GPs have then gone back a few weeks later and said, look, we'd still like to offer you the vaccine. And by doing that, what we found is that a number of our community have actually taken up the option. And I think it's understandable, because we've touched upon this, that a lot of the concerns are not just about the medical concerns, but also the NHS and about the sort of systemic problems that we face. And I think, you know, Felicia gave us a very in-depth view of some of the challenges faced by staff, especially those from a diverse background. And I think we have to appreciate that, understand it, accept it, and then try and work out how best we engage with those individuals. And I think those concerns are also found amongst our population. Only today was the news shared that an inquiry will be set up. And that's around data that was published last month from the, it was published by the Mothers and Babies Reducing Risk Through Audits and Confidential Inquiries. And what that showed was that Black women were four times more likely than white women to die in pregnancy or childbirth. And when we look at this, there actually is very little reason for that discrepancy. And so we have to accept that, understand it, try and work out what must we do as a healthcare system. Because really, we're failing our communities if we don't address these problems. In terms of that, I think one of the other things that we discussed was the genetics and whether vaccines will work. Are our genetics different? Well, actually, all of us are pretty much the same when it comes to our genetic code. The only difference is really the color of our skin and how we look. But ultimately, from a genetic perspective, these vaccines have been tested and trialed and developed in a way that they will work on all of us. But that doesn't necessarily explain why we have that susceptibility. And there are a multitude of factors. And I think the evidence is only just emerging in terms of why the reasons are for us to be, as our communities are suffering, and whether those are the wider determinants of health, and whether it's housing, whether it's jobs, whether it's where we live and the social constructs, whether it's how we're treated by the NHS and other healthcare situations, or whether there are other issues such as comorbidity and diabetes, heart disease. But certainly the outcomes are worse for those within those communities. I think that isn't a question that really we can deny. And so when we look at the vaccination program, we have to ensure that we make information available, we make the vaccine accessible, and we make sure that we're engaged with our communities. One of the things that I've seen in recent weeks, which is extremely concerning, is that with the second wave, the spread has been a lot faster than with the first wave. And certainly one of our hospitals that I visited recently, we saw less of those extremely elderly patients, and we're starting to see younger patients be affected. And not just that, when you look at the color of the skin of those patients, what's really quite striking is that there aren't many that are the majority. And when I say the majority, over 80% from Black or Asian and minority ethnic background. And that is a concern. So I think when we consider our responsibilities and so on, in terms of the vaccination, what I would say is seek trusted advice. You've heard from a number of experts today, and these experts have got decades of experience. And so when they talk with authority, they talk with knowledge, and therefore they are sharing their viewpoint from an honest perspective. And in terms of if you have concerns, what I would say is go to the people that you would normally go to. You know, many of you will have trusted relationships with the health profession, with your GPs. Please don't ignore that because of videos and misinformation that may be going around on social media. Now is the time to really find those trusted sources. And certainly, you know, webinars like this help tremendously because you bring various perspectives that help understand the reality happening, the science behind. I think one of my other concerns also is that in terms of getting vaccinated, it's all very well focusing on preventing death, but actually the issue is a lot wider than that. And what we're starting to see is the after effects. The video that we saw, what's really concerning is what will happen afterwards in terms of long COVID. And as the NHS, we're gearing up for that by developing long COVID clinics to ensure that we have the right support long term. Because I think the road ahead of us is long and it's very difficult. So even though this is a beacon of hope, without doubt, there is still a challenging time ahead of us. And I think it's important to remember that. In terms of the side effects, people are often concerned, what will the side effects be? Well, for the majority of us, actually the side effects are very mild and similar to what you might get with a flu vaccine. I had the Pfizer vaccine, and I can tell you that, you know, I had a sore arm the next day, a bit of a temperature, and I was a bit tired. So spent most of the day in bed resting. But after that, certainly with the second vaccine that you get slightly worse side effects, but that's because your body has been primed and the second dose is a booster. And the idea behind the second dose is to provide you with longer protection. And so it's important that you don't just have the first dose, which provides partial protection, but you also get the second dose. And in terms of locally, there's a lot that's being done. So GPs have set up a number of sites, certainly in the West Midlands. Well, in our area, we've got over 20 local vaccination hubs that are live and that actually were up and running by the end of December. We've got hospital hubs, and we've also got larger vaccination sites. And as more supply becomes available, those will be easier to access. But one thing I would say is that if you get the letter, if you get a call from your GP, please accept that. And if you're not sure and you do want to wait, then let us know. Don't decline the opportunity, because what we don't want to do is leave anyone behind. And so if there is hesitancy, it is understandable. My preference would be that you take the opportunity and get vaccinated. But equally, if you've got concerns, it's understandable. And I think sometimes if you do need to wait a little bit, then do so. But just be aware that that also presents a risk. I'm not going to talk for too long because I'm aware that we are going to have an opportunity for questions and answers. But one thing I would say is that when you get vaccinated, you're not just protecting yourself, but you're protecting others. You're protecting your community, you're protecting your loved ones, but also you're protecting the NHS. And for those that are on the front line, everyone getting vaccinated, it makes a huge difference. It helps us. It helps us in terms of coping. And at the moment, the NHS, we are working very hard and we are stretched to our limits. So please do take that opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Masood, for your very honest, genuine, informative insight about the vaccine. You know, your points about understanding that people will have hesitancy and that actually is okay to be hesitant to do your research, to look into things. But then you also gave the warning that that does come with a risk as well. So thank you for giving such a balanced view and also highlighting the reality of Black women being four times more likely to die of COVID as opposed to their white counterparts. Some have also asked what the statistic is for Asian women as well. So it'd be good to hear from you about that in terms of pregnancy. And again, highlighting some of the social constructs of inequality contributing to the high numbers of exposure as opposed to genetics, really showing it's not necessarily genetics that's the issue and that you don't want to leave anybody behind. So again, thank you so much for your contribution and for your insight for our webinar tonight. And we look forward to hearing from you in the plenary. We are now going to hear from Jackie Ferguson, who will be talking to us from a critical examination point of view. And just to say again, for those who are in our chat, we welcome your comments, we welcome dialogue, as long as it's done in a respectable way and that we are disagreeing well. Thank you. Okay, we're now going to go over to Jackie Ferguson. Over to you, Jackie.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome once again. I'm very thankful for this opportunity to present to you. Before I begin my presentation, I just wish to preface it with a few brief statements. So firstly, I know that we've all experienced a great deal of trauma over the last year. It's been physical, psychological, mental, emotional, the whole package, really complex trauma. And many of us have probably suffered the loss of loved ones, people we know, and some of us may even have experienced or could currently be experiencing PTSD as a result of this trauma. So what I want to present today is not in any way intended to upset anyone, to scare anyone, or to frighten anyone, or to lead you to lean to any particular direction. That's not my goal. It's simply to hopefully contribute to the bigger picture so that we, each of us, can have all the information we need to make whatever decision it is that we decide to make. Because we can't really make an informed decision if we're not fully informed. Secondly, I want to state that I am not medically qualified. I'm simply someone who is by nature quite analytical. I like to research things and understand as much as is possible the why and the how. And thirdly, the contents of this presentation are not representative of the views of the Church of God of Prophecy as a whole. These are my views, these are my findings from the research that I've done. So currently, I would say that the whole world seems to be divided into two groups, which could be categorized as pro-vaxxers and anti-vaxxers. Now, I don't really like either term. I believe that each individual should be free to make the decision that is best for them, and in some cases also what's best for their families, without pressure and without coercion. I don't really consider myself to be an anti-vaxxer. I'm not in the anti-vaxxer group because indeed I've had vaccinations in the past. I just have some concerns and questions as to the results of the research I've done and the information that we're being presented with, mainly by the media. So if we take both these terms, pro-vaxxers and anti-vaxxers, if we take them to their extremes, it could be said that pro-vaxxers are considered to be those who want to be vaccinated and also want everyone else to be vaccinated, if need be, even against their will. And remember, we're talking about extremes here, okay? And it could be said that anti-vaxxers are those who are just against the vaccine generally, per se, as a matter of principle. Those are the two extremes, and probably none of us fall within those two extremes. With these opposing views and what seems to be a great dividing gulf between the two groups, there are perhaps some pertinent questions that need to be addressed. And these are questions concerning the efficacy of the vaccine. These questions were addressed to pharmaceutical companies and to governments. Question number one. Can one contract the virus after getting the vaccine? Answer, yes. Question number two. Is there evidence that the vaccine can prevent one contracting the virus? Answer, no. Question number three. Is there evidence that masks can prevent one from contracting the virus? Answer, no. Question number four. Does social distancing prevent one from contracting the virus? Answer, no. Question number five. Can the vaccine cure the virus? Answer, no. Question number six. Are any other treatments officially being promoted for treating the virus? Answer, no. Question number seven. Can you still spread the virus even if you take the vaccine? Answer, yes. Question number eight. What are the long-term side effects of the vaccine? Answer, not known. Question number nine. Can the vaccine have adverse effects to other ongoing medication? Answer, not known. Question number 10. Are there persons who cannot take the vaccine due to pre-existing health conditions? Answer, yes. So from the answers that have been given to these 10 questions, it can perhaps justifiably be said that the COVID-19 vaccine is still in experimental stage. And this is a concern that has been raised by many doctors around the world. It's not a question that has been raised by ordinary Joe public, it's been raised by several doctors around the world. And there are several voices and concerns in the medical field around the type of test, the efficacy of the test, and the method used for testing for COVID-19. So we've heard much talk over the months in relation to misinformation in relation to the vaccine. But I would say that it would appear that some of this quote unquote misinformation is coming from medically qualified people. It's coming from doctors, it's coming from virologists, it's coming from pharmacologists, okay? And these are experienced in their field. They're experienced medical doctors, they're experienced pharmacologists who hold opposing views on the vaccine. When we talk about the PCR test, Carrie Banks Mullins was an American biochemist, and he was the creator of the polyarrase chain reaction technique known as the PCR test, which is what is used and it's universally accepted as the predominant test testing for COVID-19. Dr. Mullins himself said that the PCR test was not meant to determine a specific virus. So this is the creator or the person who developed the test, and he said that it was never meant to determine a specific virus, but yet it is still being used to test for COVID-19, and that could possibly explain why we have so many false positives, which are indeed, in fact, being acknowledged by our UK government. Dr. Mullins further went on to state that the way the PCR test was created meant that you could use it to show positive for absolutely any disease, depending on how it was used. So with these things being said, and the answers that we've been given from governments and from pharmaceutical companies, it would appear to some that we are not being told the whole truth. And it is also evident from my experience that the voices of medical professionals who have opposing opinions are being silenced. They don't get the same media attention. They don't get the same spotlights. So you don't hear much about them unless you do alternative research. We are also not being told, it is suggested by some, that we're actually taking part in trials for the vaccine. It is actually trials. Normally with trials, they're voluntary. You don't feel pressurized to take part in them. They're voluntary. You would sign to say that you know you are taking part in a trial. Now, turning to our UK government, there was a white paper published by our government in 2012, and it was titled Equity and Excellence, Liberating the NHS. This paper set out the government's vision of an NHS that puts patients and the public first. And this paper actually coined the phrase, no decision about me without me. No decision about me without me. There is actually a lot of pressure on people, frontline workers, voluntary workers. There is pressure, even though it's not mandatory currently, but there is pressure on people to have the vaccine. But this is the phrase that was coined, and it applies to everyone, every patient, even if you're a healthcare worker. No decision about me without me. Turning now to the States, because with the United States, they're always slightly ahead of us, and they started their rollout of the vaccine before we did. So on the 18th of December 2019, the Center for Disease Control reported that of 112,807 people who had received the vaccine, 3,130 had experienced health impacts. Okay, and this equates to 2.79%. of the people, of the 112,000, okay? And they had significant side effects. So looking at that term, significant side effects, this included being unable to work, being unable to perform normal daily activities, and requiring care from a doctor or health professional. So based on those figures, from the Centers for Disease Control, if we had 60 million people, for example, in the UK who had the vaccine, we could expect approximately 1.67 million people to suffer similarly. So to be unable to work, unable to perform daily activities, and requiring care from a doctor or health professional. The Food and Drug Agency in the US has produced a draft list of what they call possible adverse event outcomes as a result of the COVID-19 vaccine. These possible adverse event outcomes include, there is actually quite a long list of them, but it includes Guillain-Barré syndrome, myelitis, transverse myelitis, meningitis, encephalopathy, convulsions, stroke, narcolepsy, cataplexy, anaphylaxis, heart attack, autoimmune disease, myocarditis, pericarditis, allergy reactions, arthritis, venous thromboembolism, and many, many others. Also on that list, as with many health conditions, is death. Okay, that's also on that list. Let's not forget that with vaccines, adverse reactions, or as they're called here, adverse event outcomes, sometimes take a significant period to develop. So whilst someone may say, I've had the vaccine and I feel fine, as with any other vaccine, sometimes it can take weeks, it can take months, or it can take years to develop. But these possible adverse events have come from a credible site. They've come from a credible site. So what I would say is that ultimately, for the moment, the choice of whether we take the vaccine or we don't take the vaccine is with us. We currently can decide what is best for us. I would say that there is concern, and there is concern for a reason. I would say that do your own research as much as you possibly can, and then make your decision. Because finally, when push comes to shove, for me, I actually, as a faith-based person, as a believer in God and as a Christian, I stand on the word of God more than I do on anything else. And it is the word of God by which we live our lives. It is in him we stand. We talk, you know, we've talked over the years as Christian people about our omnipotent God, our omniscient God, our omnipotent God, you know, who is everywhere and can do all things. And our God tells us not to fear. I don't have a problem with us being careful. Yes, be careful, but we should not be overcome by fear. So my faith is in God more than in anything else. And I'm coming totally from a Christian perspective. And what I want to leave with you, because time is gone, I want to leave with you three verses of scripture that I will not read. Philippians 4, verse 6. Daniel 11, verse 32. And the whole of Psalms 91. I'm handing back now to the host.
Okay, thank you, Minister Jackie, for sharing your personal views with us this evening and for highlighting what many in the community may be questioning or asking themselves. So again, thank you for bringing a critical examination of your personal views and those of that some views that Christians may hold as well. So again, thank you, and we look forward to discussing more in our plenary this evening. I am actually going to ask our technical team if you could put the poll up again, and because there is a live opportunity for you to participate in our poll this evening before going on to our plenary session. And then we're going to very quickly highlight the mental health effects that this COVID-19 vaccine is having. It's very important that we do look into this area as well. And we have a video by Dr. Amanda Bennett that we will share before going into our plenary this evening. Thank you. Over to you, technical team. We're just waiting for our video and our poll, and then we'll go into our plenary this evening.
Let's lift up the name of Jesus and praise him. He's worthy to be praised. Let's give him the glory, let's give him the honor. Join with us. Hey.
So much to our Gloucester Church and that beautiful rendition whilst we took our poll, and our live results have come through, and I can reveal that 28% have said they would take the vaccine, 30% have said they wouldn't, and 42% have said they are still undecided. So again, thank you to our Gloucester Church for that beautiful song whilst we took our live poll. Amazing. So we're now going to move into our plenary session, where we're going to ask some of your questions that you have been bringing in all week and live in our chat today. So all of our panelists are available, and we're looking forward to giving you some of these questions. Some of them might be a bit difficult, but we want to be honest and represent our community and what they are asking. So the first question that came in from our live audience is, if an individual has already had COVID-19 and therefore has natural immunity with antibodies to protect against it, why do they need one of the vaccines? And I'd like to present that to the doctor on our panel, Dr. Ahmed Masood.
Thank you. That's a really good question. And partly the reason is because when you've had an infection, the natural immunity that you have wanes. So with time, what we don't know is that some people seem to have a response where their immunity finishes very quickly, and others it seems to go on for perhaps months. We don't know long term what that means, but certainly what we are aware of is that if you were to give the vaccine, it gives a stronger response. And so for those that may not have longer term protection, by giving the vaccine and the booster, it provides long-term. And one thing I would say is at the moment, and I think this is really important because Minister Jackie brought up a number of questions that were really relevant. At the moment, she's absolutely right in the sense that we don't have the long-term data. That's true. What we do have though, is that we have a good understanding of the risk and the benefit. And so with many of the decisions we're making at the moment, it's because the benefit far outweighs the risk. And that's what will hopefully protect people and save lives. So while we can't answer all of these questions long term, what we can say is that the benefit is there and that far outweighs the risk.
Thank you so much. Over to you, Bishop.
Thank you. I hope you can hear me. I sincerely apologize to our panelists and to our audience. In this part of London where I am, in connection due to the weather is really insecure. So if it does disappear again, my very old host, Shamara, will hold the fort. So thank you. And so we want then just to go a little bit further into panel discussion this evening. So I thank you, Dr. Masood, for responding to some of the points raised by Minister Ferguson. And just to try and help here, Dr. Masood and also Councillor Sandra, the parallel that was drawn between polio and that of the current pandemic, is that a fair and reasonable parallel? So are there any ways? Because we've had some responses in the chat saying, well, really, that's not a fair parallel to draw. One is respiratory, and we'll comment on that, please.
Do you want me to go ahead first?
Yes, please.
Yes, please.
I feel, in doing the research, I felt that it was a fair parallel. And the reason why I felt it was a fair parallel, we were actually talking about vaccines. So as we're talking about vaccines, polio, obviously, yes, it is not respiratory. But then if you look at, I could have used Ebola, couldn't I? But for me, and looking through research, I felt that in the 1950s, and I did say to the as I spoke that it took 6 years to develop this vaccine. And this was 65 years ago. So what I was trying to put forward also is that the issue around the vaccine itself, this is the 21st century, and it took 30 months. I didn't feel that, for me, that was an unfair parallel to draw as far as I was concerned. But also, if you look back now and you look at what happened in the 1950s, you know, we were, I suppose when you refer to it, we were unsure of the outcome of the epidemic of polio, the same way we're at this stage on unsure of the outcome of coronavirus now. So for me, you know, and what we said is that polio vaccine has to be topped up every 12 months. So just listening to Minister Jackie, you know, you also, we refer to them as boosters in the NHS. And so for me, I felt that it was a fair parallel, looking at all the other diseases. And don't forget, Ebola was as recent as 2014.
Right.
I'll pass it to the doctor.
Thank you, Councillor.
I'm in agreement. I think in terms of comparison, when we look at the way in which vaccines work, then I think you gave a very fair comparison, because you highlighted that polio was very widespread, affected many, and actually we had no treatment. And so by developing a vaccine, we primed the body to sort of protect against that infection. And that's a similar approach we're taking now in terms of COVID.
Right. Thank you. Shamara?
Yes, we've had another question come through, which says, since there are two doses of the Pfizer vaccine, why is the gap so far apart? And which vaccine would you advise would provide the most protection with the new variant of the virus that has recently come out? And we posed that question to Felicia and also Dr. Masood before asking about the social care system from Bishop Llewellyn.
Shamara, I think I'd pass that question on to the doctor in terms of the underneath the vaccine, because I am not a medical practitioner.
So very early on, I think what we realized was we either had the option to vaccinate people with their first dose and second dose at 3 weeks, or change the strategy. And the strategy was to actually lengthen that to 12 weeks so we could protect more people. So it's if in simple terms, if you've got 1,000 vaccines, either you can protect 500 people and give them 90% protection, or you can use those 1,000 vaccines for 1,000 people, and at least you will prevent death. So again, it doesn't provide as much protection as two vaccines, but actually what you're doing is you're protecting double the number. And because so many of our over 70s, over 80s, they were the main members of our population that were dying, it was felt really important that we vaccinate those groups first and foremost. Now, in terms of the current priorities, there is currently no recognition, if you like, of the additional risk for Black and ethnic minority populations. And that's because what people have found, or the studies have shown, is that actually age is the biggest factor. So I think, again, it does present some concern. And that is something that is a very contentious discussion that is ongoing at the moment. But really, what we found is it was the over 70s, over 80s that were dying the most. Therefore, the priority was to protect them as quickly as possible. And again, I think amongst our BAME population, those are the people that we're most worried about when they don't take the vaccine. Because again, it's this risk and this benefit.
Thank you. Over to you, Bishop Tedroy.
And so we wanted to again look at some of the points presented by Minister Jackie. There's in my note here, the question was asked, it would appear in the research Minister Jackie John was asked or praised, does the vaccine cure the COVID virus? And the answer is no. So the question was, are there any vaccines that cure, like the common flu, for example? So why would the COVID cure? Why would the vaccines cure COVID? Did your research, the Jack, point in as though there is has been a vaccine that's cured every virus? Any or every virus that there has been. That's what I'm getting from my note here.
Is that addressed to me, Bishop Tedroy?
Yes, did your research consider that? Yes.
Okay. The word cure wasn't actually used in any of the questions. The word that was used, the words that we used is, can one still contract the virus, or can one still pass the virus on after having the vaccine? It didn't actually use the word cure. And I would say, again, I say I'm not a medical expert, but with, for example, the common cold is a virus. And normally if we have a common cold and we go to our GP, they say, well, you've got a cold. They never give us medication for a cold, which is a virus. But the word cure wasn't used. That wasn't a part of the questions. So that's all I can say. But the answers that we're giving are clearly saying that even if you have the COVID-19 vaccines, you can still catch COVID-19, contract COVID-19, you can still pass it on, and you still have to socially distance, et cetera, et cetera.
Right. The questioner really was implying that there was a cure, because just like the common flu, yeah, you'd have to go back and get the, yeah, is that not right? And so you don't have one vaccine that cures you forever from the flu. So why would it be different in this case? That's what it is really implying.
I'm not sure why it would be different, and I don't think there is any, from my reading of the question, I don't think that there is any implication that it's not going to cure you. I think the point that's coming out of it for me is that we're all saying that we would like to get back to normal. And if we have the vaccine, this seems to be the general opinion, if we have the vaccine, life can go back to normal. That's what I'm commonly hearing. But from the answers that were given from the pharmaceutical companies and the governments who were asked this question, it does not appear, the implication to me is that we won't be going back to normal as we knew it, because we still have to socially distance, we still have to wear masks. It wasn't said there wasn't an answer given to this, but I would imagine by implication, if we can still contract COVID-19, and if we still have to wear masks and we still have to socially distance, we therefore still won't be able to hug our families. We won't be able to go and visit our elderly mothers and our grandmas, because we can still spread COVID-19 and we can still catch COVID-19. So in terms of going back to normality, I'm not sure whether this hope that we have of going back to normality will be realised. And from the answers that they've given, I don't think it will be realised, and certainly not in the near future.
May I just add to that?
Councillor, please.
I take on board what the minister says, and I think the comparison I used, and I will go back to that, the only viral infection that we've ever been able to cure is smallpox. There is still Ebola out there, there is still cholera, there is still malaria. And as far as I'm concerned, as someone who spent 40 years in the National Health Service, I use polio because every 12 months, you still have to have your polio vaccine. Every 12 months. And, you know, we talk about the 3 weeks or 12 weeks gap between the two vaccines. I think one of the reasons behind that is obviously that we've, the doctor may want to come in here. This has been developed at record speed, and we're all aware of that. So as the vaccine itself was being developed for COVID-19, we were carrying out the majority of our trials, and we continue to carry out those trials. If you look at polio, and you go back to polio and go back to the 50s, it's been 65 years. But I'll say to you now that things have gone back to normal. I'm not saying that with COVID it's going to take 65 years, but until the majority of the population is vaccinated against this virus, there is always going to be the opportunity or the risk of actually contracting the virus until we are not, you know, we talk about eradicating polio, but I have to use a comparison, because really a lot about COVID-19 is still unknown. COVID-19 or SARS is one of 13 viruses from that family. And, you know, for me, research and development goes on because it's necessary and it is important. But as far as I'm concerned, you know, until every child, or we eradicate polio, there will always be that opportunity of spreading the disease. So, you know, as far as I'm concerned, yes, we've done everything we possibly can and we'll keep doing it. But it is very, very important that we realize that until, you know, we are talking about millions of people here. So if it means that wearing your mask and keeping social distancing until we get to the bottom of this, then that's what we do to protect ourselves, our loved ones, and the wider community. Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you so much, Jackie and Councillor Samuels, for your contribution to that question. Thank you so much. We also have a question for Felicia, which is, what would you say to those who are hesitant about taking the vaccine? And also to our BAME nurses who may need to go in tomorrow morning and might be fearful, what word of encouragement advice would you give? And then to Bishop Llewellyn, from a faith perspective, what should we be learning from this pandemic? What can our churches be learning? Over to you, Felicia.
Thank you, Shmara. So I understand the fear, and I understand the hesitancy, because people are much more learned now. They have seen the history of experimentation before in our community. So there is no doubt that there is, you know, there is rationale for people having hesitancy. One of the things is that we must, as a society, do everything we can to maintain and safeguard our communities as well as our workforce. And the vaccine is one of those strategies. So as well as having masks and social distancing and all the new developments that have come about, the vaccine is one of the strategies. At the moment, it looks like the top strategy. And we've been taking vaccines for years and years and years. I think most of the issue comes from the lack of trust within the system. There is a greater urgency now around the vaccine. I think that if there was the same level of urgency in wave one, when so many of the BME communities were being impacted and dying and contracting the virus, I think the level of mistrust wouldn't have been so high. So for me, I have a 77-year-old mother. I don't want her to get COVID-19. We've had discussions with our family, within our family. Some of my family don't, some of my family will. But, you know, we must safeguard ourselves. And if the vaccine is the gold standard for treatment, then that's what we should do. It's a personal choice. And all of us nurses and doctors and other healthcare professionals that are going into to work every day, we have to be able to go into work knowing that we've done our best to be able to safeguard the patients and the clients that we're caring for, and we safeguard ourselves. So do not be distracted by mythology and rumours and mistruths. Be assured about what the factual information is out there, and go on the factual information. So that's what I would advise nurses. I think you need to be bold. I think you need to be brave. And we have to be able to move this this country into a safer place where we are not held prisoner by a virus. And how shocking it is that we have 100,000 deaths in this country. In a developed world, we have 100,000 deaths. And I don't want to keep on seeing my colleagues falling ill to COVID. I don't want to see any more colleagues die. So we must do what's best to keep ourselves safe.
Thank you, Felicia, for that. Thank you for that contribution and wise words for us to consider this evening. Over to you, Bishop Llewellyn. What do you think the COVID is teaching us about our faith from a faith perspective, and what can churches be doing?
Thank you. Of course, COVID has taught us quite a lot. But let me just say what churches can do and what churches have been doing. Churches have been praying, and people have been praying everywhere that I know. There's been fastings. There have been the whole of January, first 21 days in January, we spent in fastings and prayers and so on. And that is a part of our armor, and we use that very effectively. And it is of critical importance in times like these. Church are also a place that can provide practical help and support. And you have seen how many of our churches have rallied around their communities, distributing foods, in terms of food banks and parcel delivery to our communities, and has been a part of that front line. So prayer and action, and that's we talk about faith in action, and also West Midland Faith in Action. It's about galvanizing the churches to do something during this time of pandemic. And I know people will be saying too that you know, we believe in faith healing, and what about that? And that we have never said that people not to pray and believe God for faith healing, but we've also experienced, and I've mentioned in my presentation, significant numbers of our veteran preachers and prayer warriors and people who we love dearly, who have also contracted the virus and have succumbed to it and have died. So we have to learn that we are not immune from this, and that you know, just because we are Christians or people of faith doesn't mean that by itself is going to protect us. We believe in God, yes, and I'm not afraid of death because of my faith, and I believe in the resurrection, and I believe in a better day. But whilst I'm here, I have responsibility to also be sensible and don't put myself in harm's way. And I would encourage everyone listening to me to not to be foolhardy and walk in the face of danger at the thought of being a Christian or being someone of faith. You know, you still have to practically we still have to be sensible. If you see a car, you know, coming and you walk in front of it and step out, it's gonna hit you and you're gonna die. You know, well, you've got a very high risk of dying, not because you're Christian. And it was the same that, you know, people used to say that they used to use the scripture around you know, if you're bitten by a serpent, it will not harm you, and present themselves in front of live venomous snakes, and of course people will die. So I just really want people, you know, listening to, you know, not to think that we don't have faith. We have faith, and we must pray, and we must seek God for what to do in this time of the pandemic. And based on your prayers and your own research, make that decision on your behalf, on your family's behalf, and on behalf of those who you are leading, because church has a tremendous influence in communities, and what we say is of importance to people, and they're listening to what we are saying. And my what I'm saying to you, those who are listening to me tonight, yes, pray, yes, believe God, but also protect yourself and protect your family. And protect the community,
Thank you, Bishop Llewellyn, for some words. Over to you, Bishop Ted Roy.
Yes, thank you. That is so very helpful, Bishop, to give that perspective as one that's at the, I guess, at the interface serving our communities, and your response has been very, very helpful. I'm constantly in touch with Mara and I, because the interest is very, very high. And they've taken me right back to that again, Minister Jackie, where I said, your question number 5, and I used the word cure. So they brought me right back to that. And they've said, and your question number 5 said, can the vaccine cure the virus? And the answer was no. So I think the question that came into me, they were right. The word cure was used. Yes.
Okay.
And so the parallel then is, why would this vaccine cure the virus when no other vaccines have ever cured any? Councillor Sandra has so very clearly illustrated, bearing in mind, not pushing people to take the vaccine. We just want to be critical in our question and our examination and our research. And so I put that back to you. Did your research take that into consideration?
My research didn't take that into consideration. because I didn't put the questions. I am going to answer. I didn't put the questions to the pharmaceutical companies or the government. I just found that these questions had been put to them. And these were the answers they'd given. So I thought it was useful to present it. The answer is we have many, many illnesses that cannot be cured. We have breast cancer, you know, all the other illnesses. There's many, many illnesses that cannot be cured. We don't have a vaccine for all of them. And the concern around the vaccine also includes, this is another thought that I'm bringing in, it is generally well known, and if it's not well known, it should be, because it's out there, that most people have a 99.7.8, but let's just say 99% of recovering from COVID-19 if they do contract it. That is factual, and that is out there. And the highest percentage effectiveness of the vaccine is 95%. The vaccine that is most effective has been quoted at 95%. So therefore, the question is, if I have a 99% chance or above of recovering from COVID-19, and a vaccine is only 94 or 95% effective, why would I take a -4 or -5 chance of success of getting better? Because it's likely that unless you are extremely vulnerable, clinically vulnerable, or over a certain age, your chances of recovering from COVID-19 are above 99%. And if it is that there is no cure, as there is for many diseases, there's no cure, why take the risk of taking the vaccine with all the adverse effects that have been highlighted by the CDC and the FDA in the US? You know, those are serious conditions. So it's a case of balancing. We can say that, you know, we'll take the vaccine because, but those conditions that I read out are serious conditions. So it's how do you balance the risk? Because if you do have an adverse effect, you could suffer from one of those conditions. And while we were actually online at about 7 o'clock, I had a text message through from a church sister informing me of a friend who took the vaccine, a friend of hers who took the vaccine. She had the first shot, then had the second shot, then started getting numbness in her arms and pains, and now she cannot walk or talk, according to her husband. This is not a myth, this is fact. Okay, and you may say, well, that's only one case, but we've got the figures from the CDC that gave the percentage of, you know, 2.79. And if you multiply that by the number of people in the UK, for example, 60 million, we will have over 1.6 million people suffering from conditions that make them unable to work, you know, needing care from help. So it's a case of balance. It's not really that clear cut. It really isn't.
Yes. Okay, well, that's a very interesting argument that's been put forward there, and we thank you for raising that, Minister Jackie. So let's ask Dr. Masood to respond.
It's really important that we don't get distracted by the numbers, because based on what you've just said, you said 1%. So if we consider a population we've currently got in the UK of 70 million, of that, 10% is 7 million, 1% is 700,000. So what you've said is that, you know, 700,000 are at risk of not recovering. Well, we've already had over 100,000 deaths. Those simple numbers that are presented are wrong. The other thing is you said almost 3% get significant side effects. And you gave examples. Unable to work, unable to carry out normal activities. Well, in my talk, I shared to me after my vaccination, I had a sore arm, I had a bit of a temperature, and I had to sleep the next day. I was unable to work, and I was unable to carry out normal activities. The definition of significant side effects is very broad, and that's from a medical perspective. So when we assume that significant side effects mean something else, that's why there's confusion. So when you say there are side effects, absolutely, I suffered from those. But even by, you know, my own admission, that would be classed as a significant side effect. But it only lasted a day or so. So in terms of the numbers, we mustn't get distracted by these numbers, because actually they are misleading. And I think it's very important that we take into account that, you know, we've already had 100,000 deaths. That is huge. You know, as a country, as our communities have suffered significantly. And that's the reason why we get the vaccine, not to cure, but to reduce transmission, to reduce spread. It's unfair for me to say reduce transmission, because at the moment we know it reduces severity. We think it's reducing transmission. Early studies from Israel are showing that it is reducing transmission. And so you will get that reduce of spread. But if I might, in your talk, Minister, with respect, you did say that masks don't stop contracting, or you said, can they stop contracting the virus? No. Social distancing, can it stop contracting the virus? No. Again, what it does is it reduces the risk significantly. Wearing a mask, and if you wear a mask, you reduce the risk of spreading the virus by over 90%. That's the reason, and that's why in healthcare settings you have the FP3 masks, which have a greater ability to prevent the virus spreading. And equally, when we talk about social distancing, it reduces the risk. But of course, if someone coughs, if someone is walking in front of you, I mean, one of the issues is if you're cycling, if someone who's cycling in front of you, they may be 10 meters ahead of you, but if they cough or they sneeze, that aerosol will come straight into your face. So this is general guidance to reduce transmission, but none of these are absolute measures. Washing hands, wearing a mask, keeping a safe distance apart, they all combined help reduce the risk. But could you still catch the virus? Yes, you could. And so all of these things that we do, they are layers of protection that we, and as was said by Felicia, that, you know, at the moment, the gold standard is getting vaccinated. Why? Because it will stop you from dying. It's as simple as that. You may still get the virus, but it will prevent death. That is one thing that we're seeing. And actually the evidence is very strong that it will stop you from dying, because the risk is when you get admitted and if you deteriorate, I mean, it happens very quickly. If you go into intensive care, there is a significant risk you won't make it out. And that's really scary.
Bishop.
Thank you.
Bishop, can I just add a couple of things? I don't know whether I can do a third wave. I'm just telling you that. And if you ask a lot of healthcare workers, I don't know whether we've actually got the physical, mental capacity to go through a third wave. We are exhausted, we're on the floor. I think the middle of January, end of Christmas, we were just, you know, we didn't have any reserve, any energy. And so we have the NHS, it's a bastion of healthcare across the world, and it won't survive another third wave. So surely we must do everything in our power to protect it so that we have access to it, that it's sustainable. And actually, as well as communities, we've got to protect the staff that are in the system as well. So make your choice, but make your choice not based on mythology, but actual on factual information. And we, you know, the NHS will not survive a third wave. And, you know, we are trying to keep staff within the NHS. We're trying to not lose them in terms of recruitment and retention. And we're struggling. We are absolutely struggling. So people, be under no, you know, don't be misabused by this. But we are struggling, and we need this virus to be kept. I mean, we need it to be controlled. And if the vaccine is the gold standard, then that is the gold standard.
All right. Thank you. Felice. We're going to ask Councillor Sandra to respond, and then over to Shamar.
Just very, very, very quickly and briefly, and just coming back to Minister Jackie, where I jotted down here that you said people who have acted, 99.7% of people who contract the virus actually recover. That is not factual. It's not factual, and the reason why I've said that, it's because if you get a mild case of COVID, you can recover at home, and we're all aware of that, and that happens. If you contracted COVID, and Dr. Masood and both my colleague, the head of nursing, has just said, you end up in intensive care, you're less likely to recover. One of the things we're not looking at is that once you've had COVID, you can have blood clots, you can end up with heart disease, you can also end up with kidney disease. So what we are saying is, we're not saying that COVID vaccine is going to cure you. We want to reduce the risk of getting these diseases. And it isn't just about COVID. And again, we said, for me, I have a responsibility to ensure that whatever we put out there is factual. And so we have to advise accordingly. I work with a group of pastors. I know Bishop Llewellyn is here. I work with a group of 8 pastors and 2 bishops across Wolverhampton, Churches for Positive Change. And at this moment in time, we are obviously arranging with public health to come and have a public meeting with the BAME, the Black community, so we can be advised accordingly. Information is wisdom. Information is power. So what we put out there as professionals has an impact on our behaviours within our communities. So we need to be very, very careful, as Dr. Masood said. Thank you, Bishop Powell.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much for that response. I can see, Minister Jackie, that you have your hand up, so we'll come to you, and then we have a socio-political question. Over to you, Minister Jackie.
Okay, I won't be long. I just wanted to clarify. I didn't say that 99.7% of people recover, who get COVID recover. That's not what I said. What I said was that if I catch COVID, I have a 99.7% or 0.8% chance of recovering. That's what I was saying. Each individual, unless you are elderly, clinically vulnerable, extremely vulnerable, your chances of recovery are above 99%. Not that 99% of people recover.
That's not correct either. Sorry, that's not correct.
Okay, we want to keep the chat orderly. I know different opinions. This is what we like, though. It's a public space. We do want different opinions to come, and it makes good TV, to be honest. No, but we do want to ensure that everybody's views are listened to. So thank you for that, Dr. Jackie and Dr. Councillor Samuels, for coming back on that. We do actually have a question based on that small dialogue about actually how are there other ways to boost your immune system? That's coming through quite strongly on our live chat this evening. Are there other ways to boost your immune system in fight? I know we've spoken about the different gold standards and the vaccine, in your professional opinion, being the first one. But yeah, for those who like natural remedies, we do have an immune system to fight against these things. So yeah, are there any natural remedies? And then we'll go to our socio-political question. So I guess Dr. Masood, over to you.
To be honest, the first thing I would say is don't underestimate the power of prayer. You know, I think it referred to a number of, actually, from a holistic perspective, you know, immunity isn't just about medication and so on, there are a number of natural boosters, but also I think it's very easy to forget the role that faith plays in our well-being. So that would be the first thing I would say. Apart from that, I think studies have shown that those people on vitamin D, it boosts their immunity. And then I think there are a number of other natural remedies where I think there is still discussion about whether things really make a big difference or not. So certainly in the early days, vitamin C and zinc were proposed as potentially making a difference. I think generally, if you look at your immunity, you know, eat well, exercise, look at your mental sort of well-being. Those are all factors which have a huge impact in terms of your immunity. But I think other than the vitamin D, there was nothing specific that I would advise right now. But I have seen on the YouTube, you know, people have mentioned black seed. There are things like honey as well. You know, these are all natural, they are known to support your natural immunity.
Thank you so much for that, Dr. Masood, and for answering some of the questions we've had in our live chat. We did have another question that came in throughout the week, and I guess this is to you, Councillor Samuels. We've seen in 2020 it was quite a traumatic time for the Black community in particular, with the death of George Floyd and the unearthing of inequalities across the UK and the world, and particularly how international governments responded to this. We've had a question that says, why is the government trying to pressure the Afro-Caribbean and minority community to take the vaccine if they haven't always been present in other issues within our community?
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for that question, and it is a valid question. 2020 saw a lot of George Floyd's death really helps to, as sad as it was, galvanize the it was a global galvanization around what was happening still within the police force. So it was the And I suppose in America this has been ongoing now for years, but what we saw with George Floyd's death last summer was the casualness of the killing, and it was nothing less than murder, really. It was murder. But the issue around things like that that still happens, you know, 2020, you know, in the, and I'm going back to as far as the 70s, there are no consequences. When this happens, there are no consequences. So if there are not consequences, the police force will continue to feel that they can do this, get away with it, and that's very sad. The government themselves, and I feel, inequalities, and I'll go back to the Monmouth report, 2010, it actually highlights the behavior of African and Caribbeans within society, the treatment, and the disproportionate, for me, ways in which, you know, whether it's deaths or whether it's working in the NHS or whether it's out there in the community, things like education gets impacted on. So I feel at this stage, and I mentioned earlier on about death certificates. Again, that's another issue, isn't it? And death certificates, ethnicity recording on death certificates, you would think is very, very basic. Very basic, because it's a way of monitoring. When I approached last year public health in Wolverhampton and ask how many deaths there has been from the African Caribbean community or the Asian and African Caribbean community, they couldn't tell me. They couldn't tell me. Now, things like that are very sad in 2020. Mm-hmm. And as you asked the question, But for me, the government has not done sufficient. I don't think it's the government that's forcing African Caribbeans to have this vaccine. The evidence out there is actually saying, and I looked at some of the evidence that came through in January from a GP in Stoke-on-Trent that said the DNA, which is the did not attend percentage of individuals out there, meaning Black, African or Caribbean, was actually 40%. 40% not turning up. So they were being sent these letters. So I don't think it's the government that's forcing. What we have said as African Caribbeans is we didn't feel that sufficient had been done to educate us and inform us about the vaccine. And so we have to ensure that it's not, we're not refusing because we don't want it. A lot of people are refusing because they're apprehensive. And there is also still that concern out there about what the vaccine itself is going to do to us, and a lot of the conspiracy theories. So it's up to us as community members to try and educate and support. I don't think the government has been told that they're not doing sufficient to get the information and the message across to us. So I don't think it's the government that's forcing us. What the government is actually saying, and I can only speak personally and what has been said out there, because there is no policy as such. Don't forget, one of the issues also is about vaccine passports, and that's been flagged up. And so, you know, the government isn't saying that there's going to be vaccine passports, but what we are saying is that other countries may not want to let you in. They may not want to let you on an airplane. If you want to travel, we want to ensure that you're vaccinated and protected. If you're in Jamaica, why would you let someone into the country who has not been vaccinated when you have a population and a responsibility to protect that population? So I don't feel it's the government that's actually forcing African Caribbeans. We have now spoke out and say, what are you doing in addition to ensure that we have the information to make those informed decisions? And that's the question that's been put to government. And hence, at the moment, initiatives are being put into place. Thank you. I hope that answers the question.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. Over to you, Bishop Tedroy.
Thank you so much. And again, I want to thank our panelists so very, very much for saying, because the interest is very high. We did ask you to that it would indicate it would be about 2 hours, but we're running well over here. So we thank you for staying with us. We also thank our audience. We have a question from a healthcare professional, someone that worked in the profession for quite a number of years. And I'm directing this question to Dr. Masu. And the general question is, why should individuals have the vaccine if they have been tested and found to have positive antibodies? Someone who works in the profession, they were encouraged to take the vaccine, they've taken it, and now they're asking the question, well, you know, if antibodies are there, why do I need to take the vaccine?
I don't know the length of the antibodies.
Sorry, Dr. Masood.
And that's a reasonable question, because as you say, if someone's had an infection, then they've developed some antibodies. Again, what we don't know is how long those antibodies will last. And the reason we advise to get vaccinated is because it gives you greater protection, deeper protection. Because if those antibodies disappear, then you're at risk of getting infection, say, you know, next time round. But I think it's a very sensible question, and I understand. And so while the advice is that you should still get vaccinated, I think, you know, as we go further, we'll understand more about what natural immunity after infection. And we're saying,
Okay, thank you. We're rapidly running out of time. So what we, Shamara and I are going to do is to really pose, as it were, a final two questions to the panelists, just by way of summarizing. And my question is based on the then placed in a position to give encouragement, to advise our listeners. Based on a socioeconomic argument, what would you advise our listeners to do and why? On a socioeconomic argument, because there is an argument that says no one until everyone is safe. If there is skepticism and doubts, we would move in one direction, Rovax or Annex, on a socioeconomic argument. Ms. Councillor Samuels.
Okay. Can I just say, first and foremost, that is a valid question. And it's a valid question because really, what people, the decision a lot of people are having to make at the moment is whether they eat or whether they heat. So think about it. People are losing their jobs. We've been in lockdown now for over 12 months. There is an impact on the economy itself. But what we can't do is put people out there in danger by sending them into work. So from an economic perspective, we've got an extra million people out of work. I run a food bank in my own constituency. And I run a food bank because 32% of the children in the household within my constituency are classed as living in poverty. So from my perspective, we have to get people back to work. We have to get the economy up and running. But it is far better to ensure that we make sure that people are safe within their work environment or out there within the community itself. So for me, it's a difficult balance. But government, the furlough system has benefited hundreds, if not thousands of people out there. So I'm just saying that it is a very difficult balance, but we have to ensure that we keep people safe. It's no point in you going to work if you don't have good health. So you know, it's something that we have to keep grappling with, I'm afraid. I hope that answers your question. If it doesn't, do come back to me.
Thank you. And Bishop Llewellyn?
Yes. I'm not quite sure what aspect of the question I'm going to start with, either the economic bit or the social bit. But we all know, we've seen the state of the economy. We don't know how we're going to recover, what is going to be the chance of the budget coming up, etc. We know that this has to be paid for somehow, so we all have to think about how we're going to play our part in the recovery later on. But in terms of now, people ought to consider prayerfully the evidence presented to them. We are trying our best to make sure that there's balanced and proportionate information that is given to our community. Myself and those at the front line of service provision and service delivery in the community, we have a duty of care to those that are most vulnerable, those in care homes, those in sheltered housing, these are older people, and also the staff that are providing that service. I mentioned those in my presentation. We have a duty of care to protect them. So my advice is that we should prayerfully consider the evidence. We should weigh up the situation, and then we should make a decision based on the facts, not out of fear of the unknown or fear of the vaccine or even fear of death from the virus, but based on, you know, direction that you receive from God. We are people of prayer, we are people of faith, and we are also sensible people. So make the right decision for your family, make the right decision for your community, and also for your neighbor. So let's not be selfish and think carefully about what is being proposed. And I, for one, will be going on record as to say that I will be taking the vaccine when that is available for me to take. So you don't have to ask the question, Shima, at the end. I'm quite clear. I've weighed up the evidence, I've prayed about it, and I will be making that decision. And I urge you to do the same.
Thank you, Bishop Llewellyn. Thank you so much for your insight and contribution there. And my final question of the night, I'm mindful that we haven't spoken about children yet, and that has come up quite a lot in our chat last week, as well as some of our questions that came through via our email communication. So the question is, will children need to have the vaccine at any point? And that's to you, Dr. Masood.
So in terms of the initial trials, they weren't trialed on children, and that's why currently the vaccines are not licensed for children. I suspect that with time, then there will be a better understanding, and therefore it may well be that in the future we include children. But at the moment, with the current vaccines we have and the current evidence, then the answer is no.
Okay, thank you. Over to you, Bishop Ted Roy.
Thank you. And Shamara, we just wanted, as it were, a final view on the socioeconomic perspective from Minister Jackie and also Felicia.
Shall I go?
Yes, please, Minister Jackie.
Okay. Well, I suppose if we're talking about socio-economic factors, you know, then politics come into play. And the reason why the economy is not up and running, some people would say, is because the governmental response is disproportionate. Now, I know we're going to say, you know, well, we've got over 100,000 deaths, and that is very sad. But this figure of 100,000 deaths, one argument could be that this is possibly based on the false positives due to the use of the PCR test, which the person who designed it said it was not designed to be used to test for COVID-19. Our government has acknowledged that there have been false positives. And I will try to be as brief as possible. But I would say also that it seems to be quite interesting that no one now seems to be dying of anything other than COVID-19. So, for example, what's happened to the seasonal flu deaths that we normally hear of or at this time of year? I mean, maybe I've missed them, but I'm not hearing of any of those deaths. And in relation to the figures that I've presented, I just want to say that what I tried to do was get figures that were not out of my head. I actually went to what we would consider to be reputable sites, the CDC, the FDA. So if those figures are incorrect, then that's down to the CDC if we're saying that they're not correct. But I believe that we generally trust those sites. In relation to our UK figures here, in terms of the numbers, I have figures that go back to 1998 from the ONS, the Office of National Statistics. And as at week 45 of 2020, last year, the number of deaths registered in England and Wales was lower than it had ever been going back to 1998. There are a few years where there were no figures, but going back to 1998, the deaths to week 45 of 2020 were lower in previous years going back to 1998. So that begs the question that, you know, usually during a pandemic you would expect there to be more deaths. As at week 45 2020, there were less deaths. So I question the whole, some of us question the whole reaction of the government in locking down small businesses, because it is generally small businesses that are being affected. So I would agree with Bishop Llewellyn in terms of, yes, we continue to pray. And of course, as Christians, we continue to trust God, make wise decisions based on the information that you have. And if you don't have enough information, try and get some more information before you make a decision, because I think the worst thing that we can do is be, you know, make a decision based on fear. You know, it's natural that we have fear, but making a decision based on fear is possibly not the best time to make a decision. So do your research, find out what you can, and make the decision that you feel is best for you.
Thank you, Mr. Jackie. I'm going to Sia, and then finally, Dr. Sue at some point.
Okay. It's a matter of life and death for many people, and for many of us working in the healthcare system, it's a matter of life and death. And so I echo once again that the nation needs to get back into some degree of normality. What that normality looks like is it's after COVID now, so that's the new normality. And for us as a nation, we rely heavily on the National Health Service. And if we as a society don't get back the structures and the framework within the society, then our jewel of the National Health Service will fall. It's also important that we have approximately 50,000 vacancies, nursing and midwifery vacancies in this country. And so once again, we need to make our health systems fit for purpose, safe and secure, so that we can recruit the best and we can retain the best as well. I think this also gives us an opportunity to address some of those inequalities. So, I understand the fear and the anxiety and the mistrust of the population because of this historical injustices. So we cannot say, so the argument about vaccine has to be in tandem with addressing those historical inequalities. So safe people, safer society, stronger society, fair and equality. Those are my key statements.
Thank you. Dr. Masood?
Thank you. Just to clarify a few points of information. Minister, you said about the inventor of PCR saying that this wasn't fit for COVID. Well, that's true, but the reason was because he died in August 2019. Feel free, research it, Google it. Carrie Mullis died in August 2019, before the first case of COVID. Therefore, he has never made a comment. In terms of PCR, PCR is an approach, it's a diagnostic approach which amplifies any genetic code. So it's used for many different reasons. Right, there is the possibility of false positive or false positive, but generally, the PCR is one of this that's done, and it's also you take account the illness and the clinical symptoms, and that's how you make the diagnosis. In terms of the flu, you're absolutely right. Flu deaths are down. The reason they're down is because our vulnerable population are being shielded, and also people are taking the precautions. They're washing their hands, they're wearing masks. So actually flu deaths are down. In terms of overall deaths, they are up. You quoted the ONS up to week 45. Actually, if you look at wave one, there were significant excessive deaths. I'm not going to quote a number because I'm in front of me and that wouldn't be fair. So I'm not going to have a guess, but they were sickened in this. As far as wave two is concerned, we are seeing already significant excess deaths from things like cancer, from things like coronary heart disease. So this is absolutely not true. Please, yes, you're right. Go to official sources and find out. But a lot of extra people are dying, not just of COVID. In terms of wrapping this up, how do we encourage others? Look, all I would say is, please go to trusted sources, do your research. I've seen on the thread, there are a lot of questions, and I am that, I appreciate that. But please research these independently. If you don't trust your doctor. If you don't trust other websites like the NHS, then do your independent research and weigh up what's the right thing in terms of what to do. But what I would say is that our communities have been hit really hard. Our communities have been hit the hardest, whether it be from a medical perspective, whether it be from a socioeconomic perspective. When you look at job losses and all of those, we are really suffering. And the only thing we have at the moment to protect us and to help us get out of it is the vaccine. So I would urge you, do your research first. If you are hesitant, do your research, find out. And I hope that you will take the vaccine, not only to protect yourself, but protect others and to protect the NHS. Thank you.
Thank you. Over to you, Shamara.
Yes, we just really want to thank everybody for their amazing contributions tonight. You know, we're so grateful for the nuance, the balance, that not everybody thinks the same. That's the beauty of community and society. And it's so great to have different voices on our panel tonight. So yeah, just a huge thank you on behalf of our nation, our international viewers, for your contributions from your different perspectives. We appreciate it. And I'm sure it will continue to generate more discussion. And I know that we are actually going to launch our live poll one more time for our audiences to really gauge and measure where you are at. So we're going to ask our technical team again to put up that live poll for us. We might have another song from across the country. I'm not sure what variety we will get this time, but we do want to do that poll so that we can really measure and gauge where our audience is at the moment. So over to our technical team. And whilst they're sorting that out, again, we just want to thank anyone. But what did you think, Bishop? What did you think of tonight?
Shamara, I found tonight to be equally as interesting as I did last Sunday. I think the information that's been presented, very sound. Of course, we've had discussions where the opinions, the views don't necessarily correlate, and there's a diversity. That's also, I think it's, at least people will know that not a fix. No one paid us, paid the panelists to be on here to persuade people
okay.
Because sometimes there are exceptions out there that we are being paid, but people are, and they haven't told me. No, just a joke. But the reality is, none of us have been paid. And certainly, we've heard some views tonight, which are not necessarily in agreement. However, you can judge on some of those. As researchical, sound research, variable, validated, and traceable information, that's also important. And so I'm all for that. So, team, maybe ready for us now?
Yes, we've actually had our live results come through. So yes would be 29%. So that's up 1% from the middle of our show. No is 28%. So that's down 2% from the middle of our show. And not decided is 42%. So some quite close figures and quite close numbers, but it's really great to gauge where our audience is at.
Yes, well, thank you for that. And that's helpful so that we can have a honest discussion, debate around some very significant. So the question then, having thanked Captain and looked last week and this week, where do we go from here? Well, we have a number of initiatives planned because the dialogue continues, the conversation continues. We will be putting up a website which our audience can reach some of the questions that you've sent in. And we thank you from the depths of our hearts for hundreds of questions to us. of which we're just not able to answer all of the questions. Last week and this week, when combined, there's over 100 questions, well over 100 questions, and others coming in by other means that we've not been able to engage with. So we will be putting some of those on the website, and we will be being contacted with our panelists to ask them to respond to them. So at least that there is a site that you can go to. I am not aware of any sites for BME people that they can go to draw on information that relates to the plight, the situations, the conditions facing us. And so as we go forward, but we will be back again in March. We will need to resist because the fight continues. We cannot stand by and allow people to die numbers which they have been dying. But we encourage the efforts that's been made on every front, scientists and the care workers, the professionals, the practitioners, the efforts that have been made is to stand by and to do nothing would a criminal. And I'm glad for the efforts that have been made. Yes, we learn from hindsight, maybe there are things that could have been done more effectively, but I am thankful for what has been done. And so we raise this perspective in conclusion before we ask Bishop Llewellyn to pray the pastoral prayer for us. We said we would have a discussion from a theological and a faith perspective, but clearly we would want to intertwine the science, the knowledge that is out there. Our faith, as Dr. Masood mentioned, is critical to our mental health. And as has been referred to in a number of times, does not God still give knowledge to his people? Was he not the same God that spoke to Ezekiah that told him to boil some fig leaves and take it to the king as a remedy? Well, I'm not aware that he has spoken to anyone in this age, but I believe he's still speaking. Sometimes maybe our embedded theology would think God would speak only to certain individuals, Shamara. But I believe when we become more deliberative in our theology, in our reflections, we will find that God speaks to the scientist, he speaks to the theologian, as well as he speaks to the man and woman treats. So what is God saying to you? What is God saying to me? Shamara, would you like just to reflect on that point? Because I know you remarked once about what is a theology if it has no place in the public square?
Yes, and that is very true, to see that God is a wholesome God, that he's able to speak beyond the church, that he can speak to the wider world, and that yes, the church is a vehicle, you know, we talk about God's bride and fulfilling purpose through that, but yes, God does speak through government. We look at the Old Testament with prophets like Daniel, we look at prophets like Elijah who were talking to power and were around decision makers. You know, some would say that's the role of the prophetic. So to have that prophetic voice, to speak into the public square, to engage with our friends from different faiths, to really look at looking after God's wholesome creation, that really is our responsibility as well. And I think it's a great opportunity to speak beyond the four walls. I think it's a great opportunity to have our voice in the public square. So don't be afraid to use your voice. Don't be afraid to go beyond the church walls, to go beyond even your doctrine or what you think is right, because the more that you study, the more that you go around different people, your theology will expand. And God wants you to worship him with your mind. So that is a part of worship, because when you study the scripture, when you study beyond even the Bible, I know that I'm not being a heretic, I'm just saying if you look beyond the Bible, look at different sources, it really will enrich what you think about God. And God is waiting for you to encounter and go on that journey, because as I said, that is the worship of the mind, to ask these difficult questions and to really wrestle with some of these thoughts. So that's what I would say in response to that question.
Thank you so much. Shamara, before we turn over to Bishop Llewellyn Pray as an excellent summary of how we're feeling in impact. It is faith for everywhere. I believe Dr. Ravi Zacharias, deceased, he said that God gave us even all of creation, in all of the knowledge, faith, a very rational and acceptable dimension, but not sufficient to make it impossible. Think about that. Dr. Ravi Zacharias, a very solid quotation. So thank you, panelists, very much. And we're going to ask Billing to pray a pastoral prayer for us. Thank you.
So let us pray. Almighty God and our Father, we thank you this evening for your presence with us. We know that you are God and you are God alone. The earth is yours and the fullness thereof, the world and all of us that are contained within it. Father, we pray today for those who have lost loved ones, for those who have taken ill with this virus. We pray your divine strength. We pray your grace. We pray divine healing for those who need a touch from you right now. We want to thank you, O God, for our panelists this evening, who have imparted knowledge and wisdom, who have given of their time, their energy, Lord, to give something back to our wider community in terms of evidence, support, encouragement in this difficult time, Lord, that is facing the entire world. Father, we pray, Lord, for our doctors, our nurses, those who are working in the care and the support sectors, in the front line, essential workers, Lord, those that are working in the ambulance, those that are working, Father, in the transportation, Lord, industry, and all these areas that are providing support for those that are most at need and most vulnerable. We pray for their strength. We pray for their protection. We plead the blood of Jesus, Lord, over all your people everywhere, that you will give us the peace, you will give us the courage, you will give us the understanding that we need to make the right decisions. Lord, that will benefit our own family. Understanding. Pray for our governments, Lord, and those who are decision makers, both local, central, Lord, and indeed, at this time, to come up with solution to help us to pull through these pandemics. So we ask you, Father, to be with us and to strengthen us. Help us, Lord, that the peace of God, which passes all understanding, Lord, will be with us and keep our minds on you as we contemplate the weeks, the months, and the years to come. Bless us and be with us now, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Bishop Llewellyn. And just before we close, we really want to thank our sponsors and partners for this health seminar, Near Neighbours, Rafa, yourneighbour.org, the Good Faith Partnership, Sentient, and also Faith in Action, to mention a few. Thank you so much for your partnership, your support. We look forward to further connecting with you as well as the NHS, our doctors on the panel. Thank you so much. Over to you, Bishop Powell.
Thank you. And God bless you and keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you, lift his countenance upon you, and give you peace always, is our prayer. Thank you and good night.
Water, you turn into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. La, la.
Elizabeth.